Good morning.
Good morning.
So thank you for the few that braved the cold this morning to join us this morning. And along with that, welcome. I have a few announcements. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Advent. We'll be joining in all those festivities. You may have somebody reach out to you to help ask if you'd like to join with us in helping with the Advent candle lighting liturgies. So if somebody gives you a call, don't be surprised. We will be having some Advent studies. It will be online, and I'll be doing it jointly with Montgomery in here. Basically, there's some devotionals available. I can print more if you need them. They're in the entryway. We'll basically spend time talking about what we've studied during the week. So it'll be just an opportunity to kind of meditate and have conversations around anything that comes out of that. So if you'd like to join us, I'll basically send the Zoom link out in the email from the church. But if you need it, you can just get a hold of me and I'll make sure you have it. It'll be 6 p.m. on Mondays when we'll gather online. Are there any other announcements?
There's not very many people here, but at least I can tell the ones that are here. In the meeting room, Sue Berenberg just brought in stars from the homeless shelter for kids up in Sullivan County, which we've done in the past. We bought them gifts for Christmas. So if you have in your heart to take a star or two and buy gifts for the kids, that would be great.
Great. So if there's stars out there, if you'd like to help out, provide some gifts for those kids in need.
Yeah, just make sure when you take it, you write down your name and your telephone number so in case the gifts don't come in or you forget or something, you call you.
Thank you. Any other announcements this morning?
I'll just say, not many people here, but there's a box of apples in the fellowship hall that were left over from baking pies. If anybody wants apples, just take some. I want to make a donation, but I think everybody in here has made plenty of donations, so just take some apples.
I think there'll be a few leftover goods from the pie making and also from yesterday.
There's some
after worship. So.
Well, I was so pleased with the fair yesterday after not having it for a couple of years, and we were kind of like waffling as to whether we would do it this year. And boy, I'll tell you, everybody, the outpouring of work and love, and you know, it was just a warm thing. It was
you guys all did a good job. I can't believe it.
Does anybody know what money is being made?
Not yet.
Pending.
Yeah. We haven't got a count yet, but it was a great time of seeing people and seeing people connect that hadn't seen each other in a few years because of my isolation. So it was great. Friends, let's take a moment of quiet as we prepare for worship this morning. I invite you to stand as you are able, as you respond to God's call to worship this morning. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it.
Praise the Lord, O my soul,
all my inmost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion. Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagle.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
Let us sing together hymn 554.
Thank you.
Friends, let us go to God in a common prayer of confession this morning. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have heard our cry and have delivered us from oppression, just as you delivered your people from Egypt. But like the Israelites before us, we know it is a lot easier for you to get us out of Egypt than to get the Egypt out of us. And yet you continue to feed and nurture us. You give us not only our land, but also our very lives. Still, we forget your gracious provisions and fail to observe the commands you have given us for life. We say to ourselves, it is our power and the strength of our hands that has produced this wealth for us. But we know better. It is you who have given us the ability to produce wealth. It is you who have confirmed your covenant with us. Free us, therefore, of our tight grasp on that which does not make for life. And deliver us again into gratitude and thanksgiving. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to a moment of silent personal confession. Friends, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Thanks be to God and amen. Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to share that peace with one another. You may be seated. As we prepare to hear our scripture passages this morning, let us go to God in a prayer of illumination. Gracious, loving God, come to you in prayer and ask that you pour your spirit upon us and guide us in understanding your words. Reveal to us within scripture the message today and everything in our lives. If there are words spoken today that are not yours, we ask you let them fall away and do no harm. We ask for all these things in the name of our rock and our redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first scripture passage today will be from Jeremiah, chapter 23, verses 1 through 6. Let's hear these ancient words today. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for doing your evil things, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them. And I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall no longer fear or be dismayed. Nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord. Nor shall, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch. And he shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. And also let us hear from Colossians chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. May you be strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, so that you may have all endurance and patience, joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for in him all things in heaven and earth were created, things visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. It's always interesting to me how things fall in place. People who design lectionaries are beyond my scope of study, or sometimes even my attention. But I usually follow lectionary passages, and we're heading into Thanksgiving, and I'm like, oh, well, you get to talk about this non-religious holiday following lectionary passages, and right as I open this book in Colossians passage, it starts and asks us to joyfully give thanks our glorious Father. So it fits right in. Now, truth be told, I was doing this and I'm like, it's Thanksgiving already. This year has been chaotic in many regards. Does anybody else feel that Thanksgiving's kind of snuck up on you? Yeah. In Southern Baptist Church, right? I'd hear amen, right? Part of the problem may be that our culture seems to try to be squeezing out Thanksgiving in a lot of ways. For the retailers of our world, Christmas shopping comes earlier and earlier, right? And Thanksgiving sandwiched between Halloween. So, I mean, soon after everything back to school gets off the shelves, everything Halloween takes its place. I've noticed this year I saw a couple of things about Thanksgiving already, but Halloween dominated everything everywhere I lived. And as soon as Halloween's over, all those spaces are filled with Christmas stuff. Again, you might see a little bit of Thanksgiving, but honestly, not much. I noticed the same pattern. We use online streaming stuff in our house. I abandoned cable a while ago. And everything on that was all Halloween-themed stuff, right? And right after Halloween, now I turn it on, and here's all this option for Christmas stuff. I'm sitting here thinking, I don't mind that. I like Christmas stuff. But where is Thanksgiving in all this? It's not really that present. So it got me thinking about how that is the case for us. Why it sneaks up on us. Partly is because it seems like the world is less and less focused on it and wants to talk about it. That's not always been the case for Christians. This Thanksgiving holiday has its origins from Christians' practices here in the United States. It traces its roots back to some of the Puritans, which are tied to us, and I'll explain that if you don't know that already, but all the way back into Massachusetts when they first came here. They arrived, and those who were here long before us, the first peoples, the natives, whatever you want to call them, I cringe at using Indians anymore, right? But they helped the immigrants who came to this place and taught them how to survive here. They didn't really have a bumper crop, so it was Well, they survived, some of them. And they decided that they needed to honor them, to give thanks for them. And those Puritans were Calvinists in their practice. And John Calvin, who they modeled their behaviors after, shaped our denomination as Presbyterians. They took it to probably a little more extreme than we did. They said that everything that we did, we had to give thanks solely based on the Word of God, to the point where they didn't even observe Christmas and Easter, because pick up the Word of God and find me Christmas and Easter spelled out as we know it in there. It's not there, right? They said that they are mandated to give thanks and praise for everything. So that's the origins of Thanksgiving, really. Our Christian mandate, based on a Reformed faith, that said you have to give thanks and praise. And though our crop wasn't that plentiful as much as we wanted, though many of us might not survive the winter ahead of us, we are going to set aside a time, formal time in our religion, to have a day of thanksgiving and praise. That's the origins of what we do. It wasn't until 1789, when George Washington proclaimed that it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the presence of Almighty God, to obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and humbly to implore His protection and favor. Those were his words when he founded the holiday, which we mark Thanksgiving. This should fit into our faith perfectly well. That's why I think most of my brethren who talk about we don't need to talk about the non-religious holidays have no problem talking about Thanksgiving as much. If you just look at Scripture, the amount of times that you hear saying a mandate to give thanks to God, right? It occurs over 160 times in Scripture. That mandate to give thanks to God. The Puritans knew that. And they obeyed. And in this passage we heard today in Colossians, we hear to be thankful, to give thanks to God. And even other places it says in the same book, in Colossians, it says, be thankful, sing with thankfulness in the hearts of God. Whatever you do in word and do, do everything in the name of your Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to the Father through Him. So what does it mean for us to do that? What does it mean for us to give thanks in everything we do? I tell everybody that giving thanks is about attitude and action. More than the words. It is the words, right? It's more than that. Not long ago, I received a nice thank you note from somebody. It was a gesture I did not expect. It was a genuinely appreciated. And I keep a drawer in my office where I've had every thank you note that I've ever been given in ministry. Right? I need them from time to time. So I pull them out and look at them. We all need those. Those are the genuine thanks that we see. And you can see that in those actions later. That thanks doesn't stop at what was written on a piece of paper. I know it was genuine because I see it in the people who say it. And then I also see the other side from time to time. The people who say thank you in passing, but their attitude and actions of the rest of their life don't illustrate that thanks. You've probably seen that, right? Some may say thank you, but their actions focus more on the ability of theirs to nitpick and rip things apart of what people are doing in the world around them, right? True thanks is about action and attitude. And regardless of your action and attitude we choose, whether it's true thanks or not, it will impact the world. That's why I tell people when I go into churches sometimes and talk to people about whatever may be going on. Your actions and attitude, whether positive or negative, it will shape and change the nature of your life of faith together in this congregation or whoever I'm talking to. So if you're positive and you're giving thanks and you're with your actions and attitude, that has great impact. And if you're not so much, it also has great impact. Does? That's in the whole world. Colossians goes on to talk about why we are to give those thanks and praise. We don't hear about it necessarily in this, but we do hear about who we're giving thanks and praise to. God, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints of light, has given us that gift. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sin. For in him all things in heaven and earth are created, invisible and visible. Everything is held together in God. That's who we are giving thanks to and thanks for. But there is no short and simple things that we actually need to give thanks for. Scripture tells us those things, but there's so much more in our lives that we have to give thanks for. So do we? Do we give thanks for? Do we notice them? Sometimes I lose sight of that. It's easy for that to happen. In fact, later in Colossians says that our whole life, whether you do, it is to be lived as a demonstration of that thankfulness to God. That's about a question I ask myself every so often as I recalibrate the way I live my life, right? Is what I'm doing in all of it embodying a thankfulness to God for the fact that I'm even here, as well as everything else? So in that spirit, this is going to be a moment where it might be a little bit like that corny version of Thanksgiving when someone says, you need to go around the room and say what you're thankful for, right? This might be that on steroids, I don't know, but I don't care. In a moment, I'm going to invite you to a space where, if you would like, to raise your hand and share something that you might be thankful for, or some things. So think about that. What do you have to give thanks for? That's why we come to worship, right? To give thanks and praise. And we're going into that holiday to do that. Now, you don't have to take part. Not out loud. I do invite you to think about it yourself. But if you want to share, I want everybody to hear it is to share what you have to give thanks if you want. So raise your hand. I'll have to point at you. You can give a thanks and praise.
My kids.
Amen.
Family.
Roof over my head.
Roof over our head. Amen.
I've been thinking about this yesterday, great blessings. Things that the Lord has given us a wonderful pastor. He gave us all yesterday when he could have showed up and made us, you know, stop by and said hello and then here to clean up. So we've always had good pastors, but especially thankful.
Amen. Any other things you'd like to share?
2 years ago, I had shingles, and I woke up this morning. I said, "You know, I'm great blind see out of both eyes because there had been a question about it 2 years ago."
Amen.
And my church name.
I'm grateful that I have my health, and I'm still in my home. And I'm grateful that I'm able to afford to go see my son and grandson and daughter-in-law for Thanksgiving. It's a real blessing.
I'd like to participate, but I can't think of one thing that I'm not thankful for. I'm just thankful for everything in my life.
Amen. some, many, is that in the middle of December, my son turned 2, but he was born a few months early, right? And he hasn't had a single health problem. So, give thanks. Any others this morning? Thank you for taking part in that little exercise this morning, for that moment of worship. You don't have to be here to worship, right? Let us strive to remember our actions that we show. In our actions, every day, we show that thankfulness. Right? That I'm healthy, that I have a family, that I have a roof over my head, that I can see, that I can move, that I can walk, that I can breathe, that I can just be. So I invite you, as you go into Thanksgiving and beyond, as we all know, likely into environments where we would be invited into spaces that aren't always that nice, that people would rather choose to nitpick and tear apart and attack each other, I invite you not to do that. To let your words, your actions, your attitudes, your being, to be embodied of that thanks, of all those things in our life. To let it radically transform who we are. This Thanksgiving, do not lose the sight of the true meaning of that holiday. Right? Some of our brothers and sisters who barely survive, by all accounts, as illegal immigrants invading someone else's land, who taught them how to survive, they didn't know what was coming. I'm sure by now they're facing some winter weather that Massachusetts and the Northeast brings, and they stopped to give thanks and praise. Let us give thanks to God now and always. Amen. As part of our brief statement of faith, our affirmation of faith, let us say the brief statement of faith that you can find in the back of your hymnal. Let us say it together. We trust in God the Holy Spirit, everywhere giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by the grace of faith, sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and bind us together with all believers in one body of Christ's church. The same Spirit inspired the prophets and apostles, rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries from church to culture, to hear the voice of the people long silence, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks, and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, come, Lord Jesus, with believers in every time and place. We rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us sing hymn number 555.
Thank you.
about the time of our worship, we're able to share more of our joys and our concerns this morning. Are there any joys you'd like to share this morning? Gracious, loving God, we come to you in prayer first and foremost to give thanks. Thank you for everything we have been gifted in this life, this family of faith and all it surrounds us. And we come to you in prayer to lift up those who are in need as well. For those who know battles with illnesses, monthly treatments, for ongoing health challenges. For those who have come to the point when they realize that they don't need medical treatment anymore and they just want to be comfortable for what comes next. For those seeking next steps in life, for jobs and homes and whatever may be before us. For those who know the reality and sting of death, we ask you to be with them and offer comfort and reminders, promises of your resurrection. As we go into this time of holidays, marked by gatherings of family, moments together, we want to remember and lift up those who might not be able to gather with their families in the ways they have before, for whatever the reasons may be. Offer them comfort. Let them know they are never alone. And work through us to find ways to offer them that comfort and companionship the best way we can. And we ask that you hear us now as we pray as your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Friends, we've come to the time of our worship. We're able to give of ourselves for God's work in this world that's made present through this community of faith. Let us give of ourselves for God's work. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, receive our gifts, token of thanks for your extravagant blessings, sign of trust in your coming reign of justice, peace, and love. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us sing together hymn number 553. Go out in the world, may the Holy Triune God, both visible and invisible, guide us in all that we do, and empower us to live out things with everyone and for everyone we meet. Amen. Amen.